due to the rage of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly from demon possession." Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs." "Yes, Lord," she said, "but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered, "Woman, you have a great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace and mercy from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My title this morning. We aren't normally happy about the scraps, are we? Whether it be for meat or wood or paper. The scraps have a reputation of being the leftovers, the second best. Something nobody else wants. But you know, when you have nothing, the scraps can be a big thing. And that's something we need to be aware of. Especially in our faith lives. The small blessings, the ones that seem to not come out too much, the bits and pieces that we see every day are a big thing. And I always look at them as a preview of what is yet to come. So I don't think we teach that enough. That the biggest faith lives that ever happened start out in very small ways. See, we're given what we need when we need it. Not more, not less, but exactly what we need to continue. That's why sometimes we need to be totally happy with the scraps first. Because God will surprise us with the feast later on. But it's when people want the feast right off the bat, they get discouraged and say, "Well, this is all it is, I'm done." Now, the Canaanite woman in our gospel found in her life that if she could just get the scraps, she would be totally excited. She knew the scraps were worth more than anything she could imagine. That's why this scripture should be an inspiration to all of us. If we read it correctly, that is. So let's look at our gospel. I want to keep this directly gospel-based. I hear a lot of sermons around that there's stories about everything under the sun, but I like this scripture is so important. So verse 22, "A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, 'Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon possessed and suffering terribly.'" Now the first thing we must remember is the Canaanites were not the best friends of the Jews, right? They were who inhabited the promised land when Joshua was told to enter with the Israelites. And even after God's chosen people took possession of the land, there were still pockets of Canaanite people who wouldn't change. They stuck with what they were doing. So there was always a lot of friction. You know, the Jewish people, the Israelites, just didn't like them. So this woman would always be an outsider in the eyes of most of the Jews because of her heritage. But we must understand that's not what Jesus saw, is it? See, he knew her heart. She had committed her life to God and to his blessings. Think of what heart that had to be. You can bet she was not brought up in the faith. She was probably told just the opposite. Think about that. She lived in the land of the Canaanites. And here these Jews took over. But somewhere the Spirit came into her and she saw the light. And just like the verses in Isaiah that Leonard read, verses 6 and 7 this morning, and foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord, minister to Him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be His servants, all who keep the Sabbath without desecrating it, and who to hold fast to my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called the house of prayer for all nations. Did you catch that? Isn't that cool how the Bible comes together? That Old Testament reading, that prophecy that seems so out there. Here's Jesus doing that exact thing. This foreigner came to Him with a true heart. She came to Him with faith. And what did He do? He said, I know you. But the next lines in our gospel are some that confuse people. That's why I want to talk about these passages this morning. Verses 23 and 24. Jesus did not answer a word, so that His disciples came to Him and urged Him, send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. Sounds pretty typical, doesn't it? The disciples were of the faith. Here's this Canaanite woman bothering them. And they see Jesus didn't say nothing either, so they thought, oh, yeah, that's what He's thinking too. But as I've said many times, the disciples were still learning, and Jesus was teaching. And He taught them in ways that we just don't always grasp. See, they were just like us. They just couldn't see the whole picture yet. So in verse 24, Jesus tells the disciples, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. So there it gets confusing. What is Jesus saying? Was he or wasn't he going to help her? What did he mean by that? And as I say, we get mixed up. Was he telling the disciples, well, I came to the lost people of Israel, not her? Absolutely not. First, we must understand who the lost sheep of Israel are. It wasn't the Jews. It's not the people of a specific geographical region. It's not the people we think of when we, in our language, say the lost sheep of Israel, the Israelites. In fact, the true definition of Israel, for when the word was used, Israel is the Hebrew name Yisrael, with a Y, meaning God contends, or one who struggles with God. Those identified with that name are God's people, chosen for a purpose. And that is what Israel ultimately means, God's people. Okay. So the lost sheep of Israel, God's lost people who identify with God's name and who struggle with God. Yeah, that's us. We're Israel. So we're His chosen people, but we struggle. We sometimes don't think He's always there, maybe sometimes. But it's God's people, and especially the lost ones. So this woman, although she was a Canaanite, by birth, by heritage, whatever you want to call it, she fit into that space, didn't she? She was a lost sheep. Because she identified with God, and she knew that she believed that God would help her. The thing I love about her is she wasn't going to stop, was she? She wasn't letting them let the disciples put her in her place, if you will. Send her away. Verse 25, the woman came and knelt before Him and said, Lord, help me. But what does Jesus say? Again, verse 26 can make us feel uneasy. He replied, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Come on, Jesus, what are you saying here again? Now, how am I supposed to get this? Now you're saying not to take the bread and throw it to the dogs? What a comeback. Now, in our world, most people would walk away with me. Call me a dog. I'm out of here. I don't care what you say. Yeah, that's what our world would do, but we don't read our Bible with an open heart and open mind. See, Jesus was just testing their faith. He wasn't calling her a dog. He was simply questioning her motives. Questioning if her faith was really what it was, or if she was just one of the many that saw him performing miracles and saying, hey, I'm going to get a piece of that. In other words, he's asking her, do you feel you're truly deserving of this? Or you just want it to fill you up and you'll run away when it's over? Yeah. Is it right to throw this precious gift to the dogs just to throw it away? Yeah, Jesus tests. But again, we see this woman's faith come shining through. Verses 27 to 28. Yes, it is, Lord, she said. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table. Yeah. She wasn't there for the best. She wasn't there to get her way. She says, all I want is some crumbs. She said, I don't care what you give me. It's be better than what I have. And Jesus said to her, woman, you have a great faith. Your request is granted, and her daughter was healed that moment. See, that whole passage is really, really amazing when you take away the backstory or the attitude or the opinions, like I say. The disciples, send her away. She's a Canaanite. Get her out of here. So then that gets to your craw, and then you hear Jesus say, well, is it right to give it to the dogs? Yeah. That's how sin and how ugly starts. It starts small and grows. But Jesus proved again that he wasn't thinking like an average human being. He gave her what she needed because he knew in her heart that she truly believed. No. That's part of our faith, is to understand that even when we don't seem to think we're getting what we need, God's got a plan. And if we trust Him, and if we give our whole heart and soul and body to Him, as I say, this is a Canaanite woman. How hard had it be for her in public to come to Jesus? It was against her whole culture. But she wasn't worried about it. It reminds me of our culture right now. When we say God or Jesus or whatever, our culture is fighting it, saying, oh, you can't say that in public. You can't do that. But we got to do that. We've got to come with our whole heart, and God will bless us over and over again. We can be Canaanites and fight the whole thing, or we can follow Jesus and watch the blessings. We gotta trust God. We gotta trust Jesus. And just follow. Okay, well, let's say a quick prayer. Oh, Lord Jesus, your words this morning were truly a test of which way our minds would go. Would we follow the disciples and think of the Canaanite woman as that bad person to send away? Or would we look at it with an open heart? Lord, help us to look at the people around us with open hearts and open minds Because heritages and backgrounds mean nothing when it comes to faith. As your words say, accept the foreigner, bring him in. If they accept you, they are part of the fold. Help us understand we're all the chosen people if we accept it. Yes, you brought out a group to lead the charge. But they went astray too. And you came back to straighten us all. Oh Lord Jesus, thank you for being such an amazing guide and teacher. Thank you for being our Savior. We just give all praise and honor to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.